Started at an older age, especially for me. I didn't start till my late 30s, maybe. You got to specialize, or you don't have enough time to do every skill justice. So I love making bows. I love playing with stone, making points. I love making baskets and experimenting with wild edibles, all that stuff I love. But tracking is where it's at. It's really in my blood. So now I was thinking, where's Paul? Is Paul here? Yeah, Paul. Paul and I take turns talking each other into doing things. And I've talked Paul into doing a number of classes for us. My school's called Earth Skills. And he's talked me into some things, including coming here. So I appreciate that.
Oh, all right, Paul.
Well, okay. All right, I'll give you some credit.
No,
now. Okay. Yeah, but he called me.
I take full credit.
Yeah, he called me.
Where are
okay.
you based?
So, I'm sorry?
Where are you?
I live in Fraser Park.
Oh, wow.
Which is over by I-5 between Bakersfield and L.A. So I live in the mountains up there, and my school is Earth Skills, earthskills.com, and I've taught all kinds of programs in tracking. I train rangers, I train a lot of field biologists, the general public. So probably, I've had thousands of tracking students over the years, thousands. And some people we try to take off our mailing list, and they keep coming back. I see several faces here. Anyway, so I was wondering what I was going to do, because this is a large group. And ideally, if I'm going to show somebody nitty-gritty about tracking, I have 8, 10, 12 people. We get down the dirt, and I can show you some stuff. So that's not manageable with this group in that way. And so I was wondering what I could do. And so what I'm going to do is kind of do an introduction to tracking and the elements of it and how you, the different parts of it and how you learn it, how I learned it and how you can learn it. So I actually have a handout, two handouts, if I could get some help with this. But the thing is, I made 70 copies of each, okay? And so this you can download from my website. So you can double up if you came with somebody else, or if you're a student of ours, you can do two. This is one, and the other is.
I don't okay. think there's more than
so. I've got enough for most people, and you can kind of take it home with you. Look over your shoulder. I'm not gonna. You don't need to be reading it during my presentation. So, all right. So.
Let me know.
Okay, so why is the skill important? Why track? Well, you do have hunting. You do have trapping. And you have safety. Okay, that's kind of self-explanatory. Safety, what does that mean? Well, who else is around where you're camping or hiking? Here, mountain lions, bears, not too dangerous. Where there's grizzlies, yeah, you need to be aware. Where there are other people around, they're the most dangerous, actually, thing that you could encounter. So what's up with tracks of other people? Where are they? What are they doing? How many of them? How recently? And everything. Okay. For me, it's not that I'm not interested in this stuff, but that's not my main passion about tracking. The passion I have is sanity. All right, so over here you have insanity. Okay, and that's all that stuff going on there, idiotic conversations, texts, Twitters. I've never texted anybody in my life, honestly, but I guess there are texts out there that might annoy you. Anyway, texting, hustling, whining, all of those things that are back in that world. And sometimes you need an escape from that, and you need to go over to the world of sanity. So I can understand for some of you, like me, sanity is in my garage. I can go out there and work on a nice bow stave, and I can have an honest relationship with something, with a piece of stone or some basket material or a piece of wood. And there are no there's no BS going on, as there is in the insanity world. So sanity is also, for me, attracting animals, because you have a one-to-one relationship with the animal whose tracks you found and you're trying to figure out. You're having a conversation with it. You know, who are you? What's up? Why are you here? What are you doing? Where are you going? Where are you coming from? Tell me about it. Okay? And it takes a certain amount of conversational ability, let's say as a tracker, to be open to what that animal is telling you. And that's the world that I'm talking about, where it's sane over there. Well, what do you do when you go tracking? Some people think that the main thing, you come across tracks and you follow it till you find it. And I've tried that a bunch of times. I do that. But honestly, there are a lot of times you can't do that. For example, there's you're tracking a 10-pound gray fox, and that little fox nimbly, you know, heads right up that slope right there, and you're trying to follow it. You're bringing the whole hillside down behind you, and then pretty soon you realize you can't follow where the animal goes. That's true with a lot of other animals. Tracking deer sometimes, I'm amazed at how, at the space that they can crawl into, you know, in the chaparral, where I'm down on my hands and knees trying to move, and how did they even get here? Or let's say you're tracking a pronghorn. Have you guys ever seen, been watching pronghorn?
Yeah.
Well, if you do, you can kind of watch them move, you turn your head for 5 seconds, look back, and they're over the next hill. Okay, so it's not always easy to follow the animal. But what do you do with it? Well, you get into its world, okay? You answer questions, you pose hypotheses, all that kind of stuff. So, for example, let's see, we had a wilderness survival class 2 weeks ago, and we're talking about, we had like an hour, 2 hour session just on reading the landscape as a survivalist, and we were finding what areas could you trap in. You know, are there enough signs and tracks to justify even putting a trap? And how would you set up the trap, and does it even make sense? We were at the top of this mountain at 8,200 feet.
Good catch.
Thank you, nice catch. At 8,200 feet, and we go there a lot, to this particular place where we teach classes, and something was weird. The deer were not doing what we always saw them do. You know, they usually come up from the south facing slope, up over the ridge, through the campsite. You know, there's regular routes that they always would take, but they weren't there. What's up? So we spent a while looking downhill and finally found deer beds and a particular plant, that every one of which was browsed. Okay, so deer, as you know, are very selective feeders. From day to day, week to week, they just focus on sometimes a single plant that has the most nutrition. So that's part of, you know, piecing the puzzle together. In June, we had a five-day tracking workshop on private land in the Sierras, and we spent a couple days tracking bears. And I'll get to that in a minute. I've got some photos and stuff of kind of what we're doing. So we're trying to find out how many bears there were in the area, what they're doing, if they use the same routes, where they're going, feeding, all that stuff. So there are a lot of things you can do with tracking. You can always also interpret tracks, which I'll get into in a minute. But interpreting tracks, meaning looking at a set of tracks and understanding exactly how that animal moves. Okay, its speed, its gait, its posture, its mood, its personality, all that is in the tracks. Okay, so you can do all these things without needing to follow a trail. All right, so what I'm going to do is take you through some of the elements of tracking. So in your handout, the one that says how to learn tracking, you can read it at another time, or like I said, if you don't have one, you can download it at no cost from my website. But there are four elements I talk about to master tracking that you need to handle. Okay, and I believe that you can learn all of these on your own. Okay, it helps to have an instructor now and then to check in with, maybe to be introduced. But eventually, that's the way I learned it. I was a tracker student at Tom Brown School, took a bunch of classes. If any of you know Tom, have taken classes from him, you know that he doesn't tell you that you're right, whether you're right ever. And so he gives you a lot of information, but he kicks you out the door, and you have to do your own dirt time. Okay? And so basically that's the way I learned. And although I teach it, I believe anybody can learn it with enough of a dedicated approach. All right, so track identification. Back when I was first learning, and for the first 13 years of teaching, I used Olus Murie's animal tracks. It was published in about 1950, and for 30 to 40 years, it was the only field guide that you'd have in the field to take out of your day pack and look up and see what the heck was happening. So in those 13 years, since all my students were carrying this, I was very aware of what wasn't in here, what I wished was in here. And so I started doing work on my own. And I was in the field taking drawings and measurements of tracks. I have a database with thousands of track measurements that I can refer to now. It's part of my book now. But when you get to the nitty-gritty of tracking, and you get down to trying to identify, is this a kit fox or gray fox? This book didn't help. Okay, there wasn't enough information, examples, discussion, pointers. So my wife and I would be out in the East Mojave Desert, where both species are, and we'd, spend hours looking at the difference. What is it that's different? You know, how do you tell in completely dry sand? How would you know kit fox versus gray fox and so forth? And so we put a lot of work on that, and as well as many of these other things. And more recently, I could tell you that, there's a little mouse, I don't know if you've ever heard of this, it's called a grasshopper mouse. Anybody heard of that? Okay, it's a little carnivorous mouse. Wow. It's a heck of a little feeding machine. It's amazing. Most mice eat seeds and some green vegetation and so forth. This mouse is a predator. It even has a little tiny howl, like a wolf. You know, it does. I can't imitate it. I think I've heard it once, a recording of it or something. But anyhow, it eats scorpions. It eats other mice. Okay. So, this book had a crummy illustration of that. It was useless, really, of what grasshopper mouse tracks were like. The only other, and I was writing my book, so I wanted to have grasshopper mouse tracks illustrated in my book. How was I going to get them? Well, the only other place there were grasshopper mouse tracks illustrated was this National Geographic, May 1918. So it's almost 100 years old, and that would be the only illustration that was useful for grasshopper mouse tracks. Okay, so I decided I needed that. I needed to get my own. So I went out with some field biologists that were doing live trapping at a place called Lowery, west of Bakersfield, and they were doing trapping on a survey about kit foxes to, rodent populations and trends so that they could illuminate what the diet of this kit fox was. So they set a grid out of 100 traps, and they'd go out, and they're live traps, so they'd open the trap, weigh the mouse, identify it, and release it. So I went out with them, with these guys, hoping I would get a grasshopper mouse that then we could release across a 4-foot by 4-foot board with powdered clay on it. And I could photograph the tracks at night with a flash. So out of 100 traps, we got one mouse. We got one grasshopper mouse. It was amazing. I was carrying this board all over the whole place, this whole grid. But we lucked out. So I guess my point about the track ID is there's a lot to it, kind of between the lines, right? And recently I also did a little project in one of our classes on recording some jaguarundi tracks. And that's an animal you don't find in California, but over in Arizona, southern Arizona. It could be. It's definitely in Mexico, so forth. So I won't go into that. All right. So basically, what we're doing with track ID, because I don't have enough time, and I don't think it would be really interesting to you to go through how to identify tracks. I'm going to tell you kind of the concept of it and give you some examples. Okay? So,
are these going to be the four elements to master tracking, or just...
Yes.
Okay.
Yes. Well, this is all within track identification that I'm doing now. Okay. Identify tracks. You want to first narrow down the possibilities, and second, fine-tune. Okay? So if you get a little knowledge about what, you know, the dog family tracks are like, coyote, fox, domestic dog, and so forth, and you kind of know what the cats are, the weasel family, the skunks, and so forth, and you know something about the track patterns, then you can narrow it down pretty easily, actually. Okay, so an example would be gray fox versus kit fox. Same size, stride, very similar looking tracks. Another would be bobcat versus house cat or feral cat. They could be very close. Okay, fisher versus river otter, etc. So ground squirrel versus tree squirrel. So you can get it down to one or two or two or three choices pretty easily, and then you have to fine tune. Okay, so what I'm going to show you first, let me do this first. I'm going to give you a couple of examples of I feel bad that you guys can't see the board over here. Okay, all right. So I'm going to give you a couple of examples of this fine-tuning thing that people find the most challenging. Okay, and one would be mountain lion versus domestic dog. Okay, I have a friend who has a website where she gets people sending her track images, photos, many of them alleged mountain lion tracks from all over the country. She gets them all over the country. And she went back over the last 5 years just to look at what, you know, how many of these were cougar tracks. 91% were not mountain lion tracks. 9% were. 91% were mostly big dog. She got some others too. But, okay, big dog versus cougar. All right, so I'm going to spend just a little bit of time on that. So there are many times a big dog track does resemble a mountain lion. There are plenty of dogs that are whose tracks are as big. My artistry isn't very good right now. Okay. So one of the things is the cat track is supposed to be round, and the dog track is supposed to be oblong or egg-shaped. Okay? Okay. Another situation would be a dog is supposed to have claws showing in the track, and a cat would not. Okay? Number three would be a mountain lion is supposed to have three lobes on the bottom of this heel pad, and the dog usually has two. And another thing would be position of the toes. A dog usually comes close to straight across, maybe a little offset one versus the other, while a mountain lion has one of those toes farther forward. So that would be like your, if you forget the thumb, it would be like this middle finger is farther ahead than the one right next to it. Okay, so those are concepts that you look at, mountain lion versus dog. All right. So, now, I'm going to show you this. Now, I hope it's light enough for you guys to see. If not, I can pass this around.
Would you mind helping? Okay.
I want to clip this to the... All right. All right. I don't know how well you can see these. Two are mountain lion and two are domestic dog.
One is a dog, cat. I'm not afraid of the cat.
I'm sorry? Two photographs are mountain lion and two are domestic dog.
Yeah, that top one's a
dog. And
you've got to
tell me which two you think are dog.
Number one is a dog. And
okay, you say what? Number one is a dog?
Number one is a dog.
And number two, and I think.
Number four.
One and four are dog?
Yeah.
Any other ideas?
One and three.
One and three?
Three.
Anybody else?
The two top ones are dogs.
Okay.
That's what I said.
So far, no right answers. two are mountain lions, two are dogs.
Three and two are cats, and one and four?
One and three are mountain lion, two and four are dog.
Yeah.
Okay. Illustrating
the claws.
Yeah. Because the mountain lion was climbing uphill and dug the claws in going uphill. Okay. So, and then what's up with this? This is domestic dog, but it has these offset toes. Okay. And it's round. Well, here are the three lobes. This looks like it has a notch on the heel pad like a cat's supposed to do, but that's a domestic dog. Okay. This was just to mess with your head, but just to make the point that... you have to look at absolutely everything you can and the context and everything. What I'm going to emphasize here is that if a domestic dog track looks like a mountain lion, then it's only the front track that resembles a mountain lion being round. The hind track or rear track is almost always unlike a mountain lion track. The shape of it, the heel pad shape, all of those things are, so all you need to do is find both the front and the hind track and you confirm, you know, which it is. Okay. Anyhow, that was just a little, just to see if you're awake after dinner. Mm-hmm. All right.
Okay. Yeah. Okay. How about the purpose, intention, sloppiness in the track?
Yes. Yeah, that's definitely true because most people like to, they'll focus on one track that's the most clear and don't spend the time to look at the pattern. But thank you, Rob. Rob is an old friend and colleague and teaches tracking with me a lot, too. A mountain lion is going to have a very efficient, regular gait and track how the track looks. A dog is usually going to be kind of sloppy. Okay, I can tell you a brief story. My wife and I were in Sequoia at one of those cross-country ski places. We overheard some people say they had just seen mountain lion tracks on a ski trail, snowshoe trail, going away from camp. The snow was only soft enough to record tracks between 10 a.m. and 4 p.m. The rest of the time it was frozen solid. And this animal was going farther into the mountains, higher elevation, in the middle of a well-used public trail, 2,000 feet above its primary diet, deer. What the heck is it doing in that place in the middle of the day and no one saw it? Oh, and it was also going up and back on the trail like this. Oh, sounds like mountain lion.
Well, of course it was a big dog.
Okay. Something about ID I want to show you. Can you open this? Okay, so.
Dog. Snoop Dogg. Snoop Dogg.
Wyoming.
Hang a clip from the bottom. Hang a clip from the bottom.
Good idea.
Hold it down.
Yeah, hold it down. Wait a minute.
Oh,
hang
on. Together. Okay, all right. Okay. I have this little device, which is cool. You buy this at a teacher supply place. You know, it's to... Students, pay attention. Yes. But actually, what this is a really cool tracking stick. You can, this is the stride of your deer, you know, and then you can gauge it up ahead, too. It's a cool little device. Anyway, so maybe I'll get out of the way. Okay, this was an animal. This is, I want to take you through this, just this interesting track identification situation. This is Bakersfield, California, of course. This is all urban. Over here, it's kind of oil fields, industrial.
Buttonwillow.
Buttonwillow is over here. Buttonwillow is... anyway, okay, so these tracks I found under a bridge crossing the Kern River. If you know Bakersfield, you know the river is usually dry. It's a riverbed. And I saw these tracks right here. Okay. Are you tracking students of mine? What's the track pattern?
Page walk.
That's diagonal walk or alternating track pattern, you know. Left front and hind, right, I'm sorry, right front and hind, left front and hind, right front and hind. Pretty regular track pattern. So when you get that, usually you have a cat or a dog. It's not a hoofed animal, of course, the way the track looks. See the toes of the heel pad. Okay, and the size of the track is about one end, 1/16 wide. Okay, what are the possibilities? Well, it could be gray fox, a juvenile gray fox. It could be a feral cat. Can anybody think of what else it would be from you guys?
Muskrat.
Mountain lion?
No, they wouldn't. Muskrats don't diagonal walk like
maybe
that.
Maybe bobcat?
It's too small. Okay, bobcat's a good idea, but it the size of it would have to be a tiny juvenile, and the mother's tracks were nowhere. Okay, so that's why I ruled out bobcat.
Honey badger?
Okay. All right. So I was thinking house cat, but then this is too regular. House cat tracks are kind of sloppy. Okay, fox, well, I know you can't see, one of these toes is not directly across from the other, it's a little lower, so it's not symmetrical, so what's up with that? Well, it turns out it's a ringtail, which is a five-toed animal, and the fifth toe is probably... this little depression right here, although you could barely see it. Okay, so what I'm just telling you is sometimes you just eliminate all the things that can't be, and you come out, wow. And the question would be, what is a ringtail? It's doing. A ringtail is a relative of the raccoon. They'd be around here in this habitat. What the heck is it doing in the middle of Bakersfield? What is it doing? I was real excited about this. Okay, anyhow, that's what I do with track ID, and you can, if you get the methodology down, you're looking at the clear print and the track pattern, working through the methodology, finally getting to what it has to be, okay? So it's not that complicated, is it? All right, so that is the track ID part that I wanted to talk to you about. Do you have any questions about that?
Just everyone knows that the pattern diagonal, he was saying the three types of animal classification, dog, cat, and ungulates. follow that diagonal pattern in their normal, regular walk. We're not talking running or doing other things.
Yeah, and what happens, you get to know the animals as you track them. And, well, let's say an opossum moves one way 99.9% of the time. A raccoon has two different gaits, one of them 85%, the other 15%. Coyotes can do any gait, etc. So you just learn about the track patterns, and that helps you narrow it down. Okay. All right. So I wanted to move on to another area of learning, and that's about the biology of the animal. And that's really important to know what questions you ask in the field and what answers you might get. Okay. So one of the things that I was frustrated about when this was the field guide was there wasn't much biology of the animal here. I had to go back at home and get stuff off the shelf, and still it wasn't quite there. So I had this crazy idea that I was going to go to the original scientific journal articles about all these animals I was writing about, including in my book. Okay? And so, as an example, article 1995, Journal of Mammalogy, movement patterns of mountain lions during different behaviors. Okay, so these biologists went out, they radio collared 16 males and 10 females, and they took readings every 15 minutes of where their locations were. And they studied. This was the early days of radio tracking before. Now everybody does really sophisticated stuff up to satellites, but this was one of the earlier ones. They found out some pretty cool things that a tracker would love to know. And the kind of thing that you don't see in a summary. You look up a reference about this. You don't see this kind of stuff here. So one thing is they found that that when a mountain lion is hunting, as opposed to feeding on a kill, okay, it's usually, it alternates between moving for about an hour, quiet, maybe 1 kilometer an hour it's moving. That's way slower than you and I would just go on a hiking trip, and it's just sitting still for about 45 minutes, observing, looking, and then moving, stopping, observing. Stuff. A young mountain lion was stalking prey, and it covered 50 yards in 40 minutes.
Oh my God.
50 yards in 40 minutes. So imagine, you know, how slowly it's moving toward prey. And another instance, a female cougar had made a kill. And she dragged it, a deer, adult deer, she dragged it 70 yards, eviscerated it, you know, jettisoned the innards, and then dragged it another 280 yards to a feeding place. 280 yards, that's, or 350 yards in all.
Way.
Okay, so you get these little glimpses of an animal's behavior, and there's plenty more examples in this. Okay, in this article about how an animal moves and how it uses its time and how it moves, and a tracker wants to know that. Well, I began reading these articles to synopsize in my book. I ended up, and it was a stupid idea in a way, I ended up reading about 950 articles and books like this, okay, because I wanted to know those kinds of facts about the animals. Okay, so there are what I want to tell you about. There are kind of two kinds of reality when you check into an animal's biology, and one is you could call it hardwired. Okay, it's behavior that's innate that it can't help doing, and the other are tendencies that relate to its biology. Okay, hardwired. How many people have cattle? Okay, scratching is hardwired. They can't help it. You're going to tell your cat not to scratch on the furniture? Come on. It scratches. It has to scratch. It always scratches. It never will not scratch. So that's innate behavior. A wood rat gathering sticks is innate behavior. Biologists have put wood rats in a room full of sticks. They do all night. They carry sticks back and forth. They build nests. They can't help it. They got to, you know, it's just in their blood. That's innate behavior. And then there is behavior that is connected to the biology, but it's variable somewhat, okay? So a deer, this guy I know is studying mountain lion behavior in Santa Monica Mountains. And in the whole Santa Monica Mountains, there are plenty of, and they have the GPS readings going up to satellites, so they know where all the cougars are. Many of them are right next to residential areas. That's where they hang out. Nevertheless, 95% of their diet is deer. They don't change their behavior and start picking off cats and dogs. Yeah, sure, sometimes. But if a deer needs, on the average, if a mountain lion needs to kill, on the average, one deer every, like, 8 to 10 days, how is it going to get enough protein by a few cats and dogs and rabbits? It's not. Okay, that's the point of it. That you'll find a mountain lion doing certain things every now and then, but the mainstream reality is connected to its biology, its diet, protein needs, so forth and so on. And that's true for all the animals. Okay. So one thing I'm going to show you when you if you go out there and I'll tell you another story in a minute. If you go out there and think that you know everything that an animal is going to do, except for that hardwired stuff, you're going to get in trouble because animals are variable. They can do other things now and then. So as a tracker, you have to have an open mind about that. Okay. In June, we had this workshop in the Southern Sierras. We had the beginning advanced tracking, and then we had trailing and mapping. And the mapping part of it, we spent a day following bears. Okay, and this guy here, if you can see this red line, is call him Big Bear. Now, the thing about it, bears grow slowly, okay? So their tracks are grow as slowly as the bear does, okay? Which isn't true with all animals, by the way, but with bears it is. So in the first year of its life, the bears are born in the middle of winter, right? So by the summer, they're 6 months old, and they're traveling with the mother, and the tracks are going to be about that wide. Okay. A year later, the following summer, they're 1.5 years old, they're beginning to disperse, no longer traveling with the mother, and the tracks are like that. Okay, the following summer, 2.5 years old, they get like that, and at full grown, you know, 4.5 years. Well, this was not only full grown, it was big full grown. It was definitely a big male bear. And we had tracked in this place a whole lot of times before over the years, and we had seen our big bear sign many times. In fact, these green stars here are his favorite marking posts. He would totally vandalize, mutilate these big posts by chewing and ripping off huge chunks of wood from them. Okay, and that's the male bear's territorial marking, especially during breeding season. Okay, so this was his route a lot of times. He'd come down through the forest and mark here, go up here, there's a road here, he'd go up there. Okay, when we picked up his trail in June, we picked up the trail here, but he had come way from way over here. And we had teams, one team trailed him throughout the valley, up over the saddle, down into the next valley. Meanwhile, the rest of us found a little bear. We had radio contact, little bear to big bear, et cetera. And here was little bear, the yellow line, and that was the 1.5-year-old, you know, probably the first time out by himself or herself. And so one thing that's interesting about bears is they tend to keep out of each other's way, or more precisely, the young bears, the sub-adults, will keep out of big bear's way. Okay, he takes the main route, they'll take the side routes. Okay, so we're beginning to examine this, and there are there were two other bears, medium size, and in this situation you end up with a lot more questions than answers all the time, because you keep pushing what you know and you think you know. This blew our mind that this bear, because right in here are all these bear beds we've seen on these junipers. We had huge bear beds with all scats. We figured our big bear hung out here. This was his territory. And yet he was going miles just straight through. Why? Why does he go straight through? Any ideas?
Food source?
Yeah.
Because
what?
Because the guy that he
preys
on,
you know,
that way.
Yeah, possibly. Yeah, what else?
Or maybe he's trying to find more territory.
Okay, exploring.
Mating season.
I'm sorry?
Mating season.
Could be. Okay, which is interesting because a couple months before, the owner of this land where we do classes had seen tracks of a female bear with a cub right up in this area. That means she only breeds every other year. Okay? So she's out of contention for breeding this year because she's got cubs. So yeah, maybe he's going through to find a female. Maybe there's just a food source out there. Okay? So anyway, you can do a lot with biology. And that was just one example I wanted to give you. All right. Questions right now. Got some other things to talk about, but okay. Number three on the list, so we have track identification, then we have biology and learning about that. Then you have track interpretation. Okay, and what that means is looking at a series of tracks and visualizing exactly how the animal moves. Okay? How fast it's going, its posture, that kind of thing. Okay. So what kind of people pay attention to that? I ask you ideas. What kind of people think about how animals move?
Hunters, game wardens.
Game wardens. Okay. What else?
Trappers.
How about horse people? Westerns. Yeah. Okay. I know some horse people that they really know whether their horse is moving efficiently or is making a turn off the wrong lead or is out of balance or what their impact is on the horse's balance and how efficiently it's moving. Okay, so you begin to hang around with some horse equestrians, you begin to learn a lot. So one thing that, I'll get to that in a minute, one thing that I did is I was trying to, all these tracking field guides have diagrams of, you know, this is a kind of trot and this is a lope or canter and this is a gallop and this is this kind of a walk and a slow walk. You've got all these diagrams, but it's another thing to imagine you're really in your mind how the animal's moving. It's a whole other step. So how do you get to that point where you really look at the tracks and see how animals move? Well, some of you old timers would remember there used to be a program on TV called Marty Stauffer's Wild America. Mm-hmm. Anybody remember that?
Mm-hmm.
A few people. In the days way before YouTube and way before digital video at all, there were VCRs, and you could tape programs from TV. And so back in the day, this was 20-some years ago, I would tape all those programs, and I'd play them back. You know, he had programs on moose and on fishers and on bobcats and on, you know, all these animals. And I would tape them, and the whole half-hour segment, there'd be 6 seconds of a clip of some animal moving. I'd play that over and over and over again until I got down. I would watch how the legs moved, the sequence of them, where they landed in relation to each other. I just did that over and over. And then we began doing animal movement classes, and some of you have taken some of those. And we would spend one day in the field. I'm sorry, one day with horses and dogs. And we'd have this big arena, and we'd smooth out the whole arena. And then we'd have the horse person take the horse through and do different speeds, different trots, a relaxed trot, a peppy trot, an extended trot. We'd have them do gaits ridden versus not ridden. Wow, we were amazed. So what would be a difference? What would be a difference between a horse's track pattern ridden versus not ridden? Any ideas? You could say deeper, okay.
Pressure release.
Yeah, what else, though?
Longer.
Length or shorter. It would be longer without the pressure.
Okay, there's one other thing you're thinking, not thinking of. Hmm? Okay, with the extra weight, the horse doesn't move as fluidly. It's more controlled. It's actually more precise. Less. Yeah. Okay, and that's something, I didn't think of that. You know, because you have a rider, and it changes the way the horse's balance is. You know, fluid versus not fluid as much. Okay, I didn't think of that. I thought of those other things that you thought of. Okay, so we'd work that. And then we had, we have a place up in Lockwood Valley near where I live called Working Wildlife. And at Working Wildlife, they have captive wild animals that are used in commercials and movies. Okay? And you're about to see some of those. If you see this film, this The Bourne Legacy, which is about to come out next month, okay, the plot has a series of wolves. Okay, I'm not going to tell you the plot. It was described to me. It's a wild thing. Anyhow, they have a pack of wolves, and this takes place in Canada. Well, the wolves you're going to see in that film come from Working Wildlife, and Steve, the owner of it, took his whole truckload of wolves up there and spent 3 months training the wolves and, you know, for this thing. Anyway, point is, we've gone over to Working Wildlife and we do our animal movement workshop there. We smooth out an arena kind of the size of this circle and then, you know, have a substrate, and then we, you know, one by one, the handlers will bring animals in. So we've used cougar, we've used black bear, brown bear, we've used coyote, red fox, skunk, raccoon, etc. Okay, and so it's a kick to actually see the mountain lion right in front of you do this thing it's doing, and then look at the tracks, and you really connect them in your mind. So that's animal movement, and you get to that some really cool things. So then within that, this gentleman threw out the word pressure release. Some of you, if you're a Tom Brown student or have read his books, that has to do with how the foot moves in the soil and the disturbances it makes. Okay, so that was one thing. I heard about that in classes. I needed to find, for my own satisfaction, what can I do with it? How can I teach it, too? So I set out on a project to understand human balance and how it's reflected in the tracks. And under controlled circumstance, I would, you know, I'd go through a tracking box and I'd walk normally. And then I'd go through, I'd have something over my right shoulder, you know, and then I'd have something out over here. And then I'd look to the right, you know, and I'd study the tracks. from the macro level down to how the foot muscles are moving inside the track and what that does. So in our advanced tracking class, we play with that, and we have our teams. Some of you have done the advanced tracking. We have our teams, make tracks through a tracking box, find everything on the track that would show a change of direction. Okay? So 13 things, people, that's the record of number of things that a team has found, 13 different possible things that you could see in a track that would show that the animal or person changed direction. Okay, and then you get to all these little head turns, little nuances. Okay, so suffice it to say, I spent a long time experimenting looking at that. Okay, so what I want to do is, Rob, could you help for a second? Behind the tree there is a cardboard with some images on it. Yes, sir.
When you're doing your walking, through the different things, do you guys use different substrates? In other words, like, what would that track look like on sand? What would that track look like on gravel?
Right. Okay. I'll answer that in a second. I have to get a drink of water here. The one we just did. We just did this in a feline tracking workshop we had in May at Working Wildlife, and we had I got a half a scoop of sand at the lumber yard in a pickup truck. We drove it in there, and we made a surface about that deep of wet sand. It was about 15 feet long by 4 or 5 feet wide. And we had the mountain lion go through there. We were filming the mountain lion doing different things and seeing how it moved. And the first thing we noticed is, because the sand was so deep and soft, it was altering its normal gait because it was fighting for balance. Mm-hmm. It's like you go to the beach and you have to play to keep balance. And so we scraped off most of it and changed it. So, oh wow, that affects how it moves. So, we couldn't vary it too much because we had 2 hours with the cougar, and we're paying $400 for the couple hours with the cougar, and we couldn't do too many things. We wanted to make efficient use of what we spent there. Okay, this is what I was going to ask you to not tape if you would be so kind. But I'll have that up there to refer to. Is trailing. Trailing means following an animal. And for years I've done all these other things. I spent a lot of time doing this kind of stuff, and as you know, biology and all that stuff. But one kind of bug I had was I didn't think I was very good at following animals for long distances, okay? Or even when I got stuck, I wasn't that good at trailer. Actually, we teach that in our advanced tracking classes. I've done it tons of times, but I never thought I was that good at it. So, in 2008, I made an assignment to myself. By the way, this is the last section, so I'm going to let you go in a few minutes. Anyhow, so I had an assignment for myself that I was going to trail 100 animals. And each time, I was going to... Okay, there's such a thing trailing an animal when you hit the wall. You lose the trail, okay? And this is typical losing a trail across dry pine needles. What the heck do I do now? You know, how do I get out of this mess? And so I said to myself, if I can learn this, I was going to trail 100 animals And each time I was going to break through the wall any way I could, at least twice, often more than that, but at least twice. And I was going to find whatever I could to find the trail again. And so what I ended up with, I have a draft monograph that I'm going to put out eventually about this, but I have all these practical techniques that I used that are in blue. And they are, for example, keying on the behavior mood of the animal, pressure releases that would show a change of direction, follow the logical route, eliminate other choices, cross track or sign cut, methodical tracking. Those are all practical. And I discovered after the end of this 2.5 year project that 49% of the time, almost identical to the practical, I used intuitive techniques. Okay? And what that means is I felt the animal just pull me in a direction. Or I saw an image of the animal and went over and there was its track. That kind of thing. And At first when I entered into it, I didn't trust the intuitive that it was really, that it would work. I discovered for me the intuitive stuff that I just described, it worked about 70 to 80% of the time. The rest of the time it sputtered, but way often enough to really trust it. Okay, so for example, this particular instance, I was trailing a bear. It was in wet pine needles. You could not see a track because it had rained the night before. The whole bed of pine needles throughout the forest was uniform. You couldn't see a track. If you got down on your hands and knees and felt with your palm, you could feel a depression under the pine needles where the bear had compressed it, and then the pine needles had come back up. So what the heck do? Do you crawl on your hands and knees the whole way?
So if you have your stride stick, wouldn't that...
Well, you're not... Yeah, but after a while, you want to go more than 5 or 10 yards,
right.
You know, in an hour. You want to say, okay, does it go there? Did it go there? Did it go there? Where am I going to jump to find the trail? And that's where the intuitive comes in. Sometimes it's a pull. It's just like a magnetism or your gut says, oh, obvious, it's over there. Or like I say, sometimes you see the image of the animal, like a clear image. It was right there. And you go over there and there's the track. So, yes.
Hey, Jim, how much of that intuitive is based on all of your experience?
Yeah.
And how much on mysticism?
Yeah, of course, I wouldn't use the word mysticism. I think almost all of it is the communication with the animal as opposed to experience. Because in most of those cases, the animal ended up going where I didn't think it was going to go. Okay, and we've had experiences we do some stuff blindfolded in our classes. And I could say many of these times I could have gone blindfolded and say, where's the animal? And I journaled really, really intently about it. I wasn't trying to prove anything. I was very honest with what worked and what didn't work. And, I think it's definitely a communication with the animal that you have.
People replicated.
That was my experience.
It?
I'm sorry?
Have you had students who have been able to replicate?
Yeah. Yeah. In fact, I've been experimenting with that in our class last month. I was trying some of these techniques. What you do when you hit the wall, and it's a work in progress. I'm going to get a lot more experience, hopefully, with our students to see if that can be replicated and trusted. But honestly, when you're there with the animal, just the two of you. Okay, and there's nobody telling you if you're right. It's just the two of you. Then the key things I discovered that you need to have: one, a completely open mind, without any expectation of where what your animal did and where it went. Complete open mind, and you have to have a commitment to the relationship with your animal.
Have you ever been in a relationship?
And if you don't, and if you don't have a commitment to the relationship, if you don't have a commitment to the relationship, it's like you haven't tuned into its channel or whatever, you know. Yeah. But that's how I found out. Yeah.
You're still talking tracking or marriage counseling?
I'm sorry.
You're still talking tracking or marriage counseling?
Yeah, really. Yeah.
Jim, have you ever had the experience where you're trailing an animal? And you discover the animal has decided to start feeling you.
Yes.
Now Now that gets you real intimate.
Yeah, that's
with an
interesting.
Animal.
Yeah. 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 I have had that. Okay.
Dating. No.
I'll take a couple other questions. I apologize for going so late when you're getting into the dusk. But a couple other questions. Here? No.
What was the fourth thing on your list?
The fourth is the trailing, you know, the trailing techniques.
What's on tap for tomorrow?
Tomorrow, it's going to be a little bit briefer because I've got to get out of here. I dragged this trail up here a little bit. We're going to see what's fresh on that. I dragged this trail. I set up a couple tracking boxes.
Great.
So we're going to go out and see what's fresh out there, interpret a little bit. Rob is going to help me with some animal signs and some tracks and that kind of thing.
I'll show you where I saw a fox last night.
All right.
Let me show you.
Cool. Yeah. After we break up, we can. Yeah.
Is that right after breakfast?
Yes, be right after breakfast. Yeah. It's supposed to be 8 o'clock, but, you know, soon after breakfast we can get it going. I'd like to do that.
Jim.
Yes.
Despite the fact that Paul Campbell is scoffing, I think this was an excellent presentation.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Okay, I
do
have
the last part, Paul. The last part about animal communication.
Yeah. Put money in your bag.
Okay, I do have books here, and I'm going to leave right after tomorrow's presentation. So you want to pick one up, you can get one tonight or early tomorrow morning.
The domestic dog right here, domestic dog right there.
Let's see, what is that, a fox track? Can you see that from there? Yeah, that's a gray fox, I think.
Yeah, it's a gray fox, yeah.
Yeah, so that's a gray fox. So I'll mark a few more, and then you can come around and look at them. Okay, that's domestic dog, domestic dog. So one thing, of course, you measure tracks in order to distinguish. I'm saying domestic dog versus gray fox. Gray fox, of course, you could have a little dog the size of a gray fox. But in general, domestic dogs are really sloppy walkers, okay? You know, not only is the track pattern irregular, but also how the foot hits the ground is, if you watch a dog walk, the foot kind of slaps and scuffs. And if you watch a fox...
Sideheading, mirror look, so you can use the light as an advantage. If you're in bright daylight, you know, looking down, it washes out the track. You can get a, believe it or not, a flashlight and angle it. Angling will create some shadows in it. It's easier to see that way. Just something what you're looking for. Depending on the animal, think about how many toes and heel pads. Look for that.
I'm going to show you the, a lot of these marked with these sticks over here are a striped skunk. So you can get down and look at those. And I'll just let you look at these.
You have any questions? Here you guys step over.
You know, one or the other. If it's a lope, I don't know if you guys can, if you know, if you get an image in your head of a cantering horse, you know, ba-dum, okay, that's a lope, really. And so when the feet hit the ground, they're going to hit and roll. Okay, and a loping animal, the shoulders come down and back up, down and back up. Okay, that's your cantering horse like that. And so the tracks in a lope would show a certain amount of digging in and rocking motion. Okay, so these are flat, so they don't show that. So it's just a regular meandering.
What about that one?
room is.
This is across the park, right?
Yeah, it does. Oh, it's a bird.
Yeah, hopping. That's a hopping bird.
Thank you.
Okay, so if you stay here just for a second, actually, no, I'm going to take you over here. But first, the other alternative to a gray fox would, I mean, to a striped skunk would be a spotted skunk, and which it would also be here.
Can you move?
Great.
Thank you.
And the spotted skunk, this would be a typical size for an adult spotted skunk. You're making shadow too. Okay. And so, how do you tell? Well, sorry. Okay, so here's the difference. A spotted skunk, if you have the field guides, page 262, a spotted skunk has all this segmentation in the heel pad area behind the toes, all of these, this kind of knobbiness, and the striped skunk is pretty uniform, like that. And that's the real difference. Plus, the striped skunk claws are quite a bit bigger. So, this is a front track, and the claws are way out here. Plus, you don't see all the segmentation in here. So that makes it a striped skunk.
Jim, do you remember all these subtle differences between the different species, or do you look it up in your book, too?
There are times when I need to refer to an image if it's an animal whose tracks I don't see that often. For example, long-tail weasel tracks I see once every couple years, just where I track. Ringtail I'll see once a year maybe, etc. But most of it I've got, you know.
Jim, while you're here, what is all of this pattern here? Is that bird pecking, or is that
dew from what?
I think it's drops. Maybe not.
It's
too delicate for bird, I think, though.
You think it's what, Jim?
Drops.
Oh, drops from...
No. So, okay, I want to show you something else. Yeah.
So looking at this, can you tell approximate time? I mean, we know you prepare this calf, but if you were... Or better question would be, how do you tell?
How do I tell?
Yeah.
Use the force.
Yeah, well, you can, yeah, sure. Energy in the track.
Call the study, Rob.
Yeah. You know...
Thanks, Chris. Well, what I mean is...
So I was last night I was lying in my sleeping bag, and I was noticing the more, you know, toward the morning it started to get damp. I was sleeping not in a tent, I was just out.
Right.
Like, oh, man, this moisture is kind of settling, a few drops and things. I almost got out of my sleeping bag to run and make some thumbprints to see what the tracks would have been before and after that. You know what I mean?
Right.
So... That's the answer. I would need to do that to really fine-tune it.
But I mean, normally would a 3-hour track would be clearer than a 10-hour track?
Yes.
Okay.
Yeah. Depends on the amount of moisture in the track. But
wind.
I don't know.
Weather.
Where's Rob?
Did he go back?
That's a hind on top of the front. That's a hind on top of the front. That's a hind on top of the front. And so... this is your regular diagonal walk, and actually one thing that okay, interesting, 15 inches, okay, let's see, sure, that's 12 inches. So that's a kind of a longer stride. Most little dogs, domestic dogs, with that foot that small, have real short legs, right? They won't walk like this. They won't make. Now there might be some dogs there. 400 breeds of dogs in the world, so who knows. All right, I'm going to show you one thing. Put right here, then I'm going to show you something else. I put one of these boxes in here last night.
This looks like a school area because for little mice and whatever, because we had a lot of little hiding places, holes, diggings. It's just a good edge habitat for little critters, so I baited this.
I'll pass this around. Yeah. So this is pretty cool. Actually, you see some tail drags here.
Oh yeah.
So this is a mouse, and so yeah, there was a party in here.
Yeah.
Yeah. But anyway, you see little. The hind tracks have 5 toes, and the front tracks have 4 toes. So I'll let you, I'll show you guys right here. Yeah.
Hi, nice to meet you,
fellas. I don't know, it could have been one, say there were about 4 or 5 little peanuts in there. And so it could be one mouse that many times. You could spend the whole day deciding how many mice there were, but my guess is probably one. Back and forth a lot.
He's busy.
So, pass that around. Yeah, I put some peanuts in.
So he went to the
mouth
again.
Yeah, yeah. There you go. Here are the toes. 1, 2, 3, 4 toes. Heel pad. Exactly. There you go.
And right those are about 15 inches apart, too?
Yeah.
Was that a mouse?
Huh?
No, gray fox.
Gray fox. Yeah. So what do we see here?
Now, remember he had that pointing stick? Here's your tracking stick. This is basically its gait.
Yeah.
Right, left and right gait, right? It moved from the left foot, that's left gait, right side, right gait. But look at that. You measure it here.
Indy, where's your
measure it here. Huh? You're looking at the next one. It's got to be somewhere in your skin.
Yeah,
your
area.
So that's just, you get a regular stick.
There you go.
Go ahead.
It's got bands on here.
There you go. Exactly. You can, whatever, you know, just... piece of willow I was just working with.
Right?
There it is.
Mark it.
So you're marking it. So I'm guessing the next one.
Little.
Right.
That's length of the track, and that's in there.
Well, that's a seed track.
Up here is a stride.
No, right, is it? Just scanning right here.
It's wild.
Okay, so what do you guys think? Last night?
What?
What do you guys think last night?
Yeah.
Okay.
It's hard to say.
There it is.
Morning, you know,
yeah.
The river moisture
harder.
It
does.
Yeah.
Well, a lot of foot traffic in here, too, and their previous vehicle tracks and stuff like that. So, yeah, it was definitely last night.
See how easy that was with just a tracking stick?
So,
rather than, you know,
I think it's way cool that, it's like the animals have the secret lives after we all go to bed.
Yeah.
And we think we're in this whole place and we haven't seen animals all day, and then suddenly all these foxes are
here every night.
Yeah.
I was two nights ago, about 3 a.m. went to the bathroom. Lots of big raccoons.
Oh, yeah.
Big raccoons. Yeah, lots of them.
Okay.